Hey guys, it's Adam from NewsPixel, and welcome back. Today I want to take a unique perspective, a different twist on something that gets a whole lot of heat for justifiable reasons. Social media, internet. I am not unaware, being somebody who runs a YouTube channel, being somebody who's a father of three, being somebody who runs an online school, that there are many real risk factors involved in over-consuming social media, Instagram, YouTube, TikToks, where you can find yourself in this endless loop of doom scrolling and dopamine hunting and all that kind of stuff. I'm very much aware of that, and I'm very sensitive to that. But being in the position I am, as a teacher, as a YouTuber, and as a father, I'm also very much aware of how social media has served to provide us as a human race with a very powerful and wonderful tool. And that is our ability to start becoming far more vocal, with our personal selves, with regards to subjects that are very, very challenging. And we are now, as a result of this kind of communal conversation that we're having, because I'm just a guy sitting here in my house and I turn a camera on and I can break that fourth wall with my audience. I can get out and reach an audience that I couldn't if I was walking down the street yelling at the top of my lungs. That this allows me, much like a celebrity would, in a sense, to share my life, share my stories. And when enough of these stories, enough of these realities, these testimonies of our own life start to culminate, you start to develop this platform of understanding that goes far beyond what we've ever had access to in the past. If I ever suffered, for instance, with some emotional struggle, or some family struggle, or some relationship issue, or if I'm struggling with my career and trying to find out how to get somewhere with all of this hard work and money and time, that I now have access to this community of people who've been through that and can share their experiences. And even if they don't provide me with a solution, which very often they do, they can at least provide me with a sense of community. They can provide me with a sense of oneness with other people that we've been through this together. And honestly, that is the foundation of my art talks. My art talks are not me sitting here as some fancy schmancy pro telling you how to, you know, the five best tips on how to make money as an artist, or 10 tips on how to overcome this or that. Although there's many videos out there by many of my friends that are absolutely phenomenal, and I do binge watch their videos all the time. So I'm not dismissing that formula of video, but that's just not what I feel. I don't feel that's the best that I have to offer in this regard. I think that other people are probably much more capable of doing that than myself, much more qualified. But what I am very qualified at is messing up. What I have been very qualified at throughout my career is failure, is not fitting in, is trying through sheer will and brute force to try to make a career for myself, practicing until my fingers were bruised, you know, knocking on doors until my knuckles were bleeding, and getting nothing in return. And then, maybe through miracle, maybe through pity, or maybe through hard-earned talent and effort and patience, I did find my successes. I did work in cool studios. I did get prestigious jobs. I did get to sit down and at fancy tables in fancy restaurants with important people and talk shit, okay? And eventually I did end up finding my own thing, and I started my school online, and it's been amazing. It's been going on since 2015, and it is my dream job. It is something that puts a big smile on my face every single day. And I've, as a result, had a chance to meet countless incredible people that I can now call friends. But I want to shine a light on the hard part. I want to shine a light on the difficulty, on the struggle, on the doubt, on the imposter syndrome. Something that I do very, very often on my channel. Because one of the things, one of the professional skills that I learned over the years, one of the perspectives that I adopted over the years, transformed how I addressed my past. And the fact that I can sit here and so openly and so flippantly tell you that I've fucked up in so many ways. You know, all of my colleagues are sitting there, you know, 5 years into a company doing great, and I last 6 months and they kick me out the door, you know? And I tried my best, but for some reason my abilities, some vampire came in and exsanguinated my abilities at 6 months, and they told me to take a hike. Other times I did great. But I remember those failures, and I remember how it felt to have to walk out a door realizing I don't have a job to go to tomorrow. What the hell am I going to do? I don't have a source of income. What the hell am I going to do? And now I'm starting to sit there and yet again brace myself for the fact that I'm going to have to sit in some stupid unemployment office and with a bunch of people who look like they just want to jump off a bridge and just sit there and under these ugly lights, speaking to somebody who's used to hearing people having a hard time, sir, I get it. Yes, okay, sir, I understand, but you're unfortunately going to have to follow protocol, okay? To coming home and having to break hard news to my partner, to feeling that feeling of self-doubt, to rekindling that sense of, I don't know what the hell I'm doing with myself, and I don't even know if I'm good enough. Living in the dark a lot. This was a very, very common part of my career up until I started to make some really important realizations. I was a late bloomer. I was a hard learner. And I used to regard that as a bad thing. Now I don't. Now I wear that like my badge of honor. The fact that I had to really, really earn every single step of the way. I really had to overcome big obstacles, personal obstacles, emotional obstacles, technical obstacles, professional obstacles, slowly climbing up that ladder one at a time. I wear that like a badge of honor. And I wouldn't have it any other way. And I'm going to tell you why. And hopefully what I'm going to share with you today, my professional perspective that I'm going to share with you today, is going to help you reevaluate who you are, where you are at a different phase in your life, and help you to realize that although you might feel like you're a complete useless piece of crap who's not going to get anywhere in his life or her life, depending on where you are in your life, you're not nearly as bad off as you are. In fact, once you're finished listening to me to tell you what I'm going to tell you, you might not want things to be easy in the first place. The best way to start this conversation, the best way to initiate this conversation, is to empathize with you, to share with you, since I'm now approaching 50, I'm 48 at the time of this recording, okay? Shout out to anybody who was born in 1975. I want to share with you feelings that I can remember at different phases in my life. And you tell me in the comments below if this is something relatable to you. Okay? I grew up being the guy, I was Adam the artist. I was Adam the artist from 5 years onwards. I remember the day I realized I was an artist. I think I've shared that story where we had a Scholastic book art competition and I actually beat my friend Daniel, who was like the hot shot artist of the school. And the only reason I won that competition is because I was a chubby, geeky nerd kid that nobody wanted to hang around with. But because it was an anonymous vote, I got picked and I won that competition. And that made me realize, holy shit, I'm not useless and I can actually draw. I remember that day. And that was my identity moving forward every day henceforth. And then I ended up professionally educating myself and all that kind of stuff. When I got into education, once I decided to really pursue this professionally, which was kind of a no-brainer, I got caught up in technicality. Up until that point, when we're young, when we're my son's age, who's 11 years old, and I'm just having fun drawing, then you don't question your technical skill. You know, maybe mom or dad will tell you that you're good at art, and that gives you a little bit of a boost, and you keep going, but you're really just a nerd. You're really just a geek. To you, as Anthony Jones would put it, you are fully involved in the cool factor of art, the best place to be, in my humble opinion. And you just draw the shit that you think is cool. Maybe it's an anime. Maybe you're into Spy X Family. Maybe you're into Kirby. Maybe you're into Zelda. Okay, and you're these. This is your fan art over other people, and you produce that art and you recreate that art. And then you get professional. And when you get into school, all of a sudden you're realizing all of these technical skills that you need to develop. You need to learn about perspective and composition. And you need to learn about visual storytelling and value and color and staging and architecture and clothing design and anatomy. And oh my God. And you start to realize everything that you don't know. And furthermore, you're being taught by and you're being surrounded by other people who are more professionally trained than you are. And you look at them and you go, oh my God, I want to be that. But the only way I'm going to get there is to do what they tell me to do and learn these fundamentals. And you're right in thinking so. You do need to learn these fundamentals. So you do. And then you find you've gone through the school, you've paid your dues, you've had your vernissage at the end of your course. And now they open the doors and they kick you out on the road, ass in the air, and they go, good luck. Slam. And there you are, sitting on the side of the road, trained, without one even iota of a fucking clue what to do with that education that you've got. That, depending where you live, may or may not be one of the most expensive things in the world that you're going to be having to pay for the next several decades, if you're lucky. or maybe not, depending on your situation. But here you are, left on your own, you're educated and unemployed, and you have no idea how to get a job. So you start cold calling, you start asking professionals and going to conventions and trying to scrounge about, going online, watching tutorials, trying to figure out how the hell you're gonna get paid with this skill, this trained skill. I'm not just some guy walking off the street trying to get a job. I'm a trained artist now. I've invested my time and energy into this. But nobody's returning your damn calls. Yeah, but everybody's returning her calls because she's amazing and she was the class prodigy and everybody loved her to pieces. The lowish of the class, right? The ones that were just kind of like, wow, they're like art gods. Okay, fair enough. But what about the rest of us? What about the rest of us common artists who have big dreams but might not have that person's talent and trying to find a name for yourself? And this can go on for a year. 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. Now you're not a 21-year-old, a 22-year-old, a 25-year-old trying to figure out how to make a career for yourself. You're a fucking 30-year-old. And because you can't find regular work, you're working at a restaurant, you're working at a pizzeria, you're waiting, you're doing phone customer service just to make ends meet, because nobody's hiring you. And you speak to this professional, and they say, well, you should be doing this. And then you speak to another professional, and they completely contradict what the first professional said, and they tell you to do that. And you get into such a pattern of feeling like you don't know what you're supposed to be doing and that you're not getting jobs, that the rhythm of just working this part-time job that's turning out to be a very long-term job is actually the reality that you should start acclimatizing yourself to. You should start getting used to the idea that I'm not going to get a professional job. I'm already 30, 35 years old, or whatever the case might be. I'm still in and out of mommy's house. My relationships kind of are very rocky because everybody's waiting for me like, come on, buddy, you're going to get your shit together, right? And you're sitting there going, I'm trying, but I don't know. I'm doing everything I can. I update my portfolio all the time. I work my ass off. I ask every professional out there if they can help me out, and I don't know what to do. A lot of my students, a lot of the people that I talk to are people who I'm helping them to set their minds straight and give them a good perspective, a proper perspective on what to do with the skill, and furthermore, recognize what their skill is. Show them what they're good at, because at that point, when you've been doing this for 5, 10 years, you don't know your ass from your elbow at that point, do you? You'll just do anything to get a job. And that's a rabbit hole. That's a trap you'll never get out of until somebody throws you a lifeline and pulls you out. That's just the reality of it. But let's backpedal a little bit. Do you know how many students I've taught? Do you know how many artists I've spoken to who have the audacity to tell me? I'm 22 years old. I'm educated. I have a college or a university degree. And I still haven't been able to land a regular job. And I'm really starting to feel like, oh, I don't know, Adam. Is it too late? Have I missed the boat? Because I don't know. I just feel like I should have made it by now. And I try not to smirk because the person who I had spoken to a couple of hours earlier was 35 asking exactly that same question, right? And I'm like, my dear friend, you have not missed the boat. And I'm listening to them talking about having imposter syndrome and having an identity crisis. And I'm sitting there going, yeah, you are who you are. And your identity is very, very solid. You have your adult identity by then. I would argue that who you are at 13 is very close to who you're going to be at 22 as well. I know, because I have a 14-year-old and a 22-year-old as well as an 11-year-old. But there's so much you need to experience. There's so much going on that those answers haven't reached you yet at 22. So I'm there to let them know. I'm there to let you know. Don't worry. There's nothing wrong with you. You're educated. You're passionate. You're patient. You know how to put your ego aside and look at your artwork objectively. You understand what your strengths are and where you want to go with it. I'll help you. Let's go. Let's go in that direction. But you haven't missed the boat, you're not an imposter, and your skill is fantastic. And if it's not, then as a professional, I'll say you need to focus on those fundamentals. You haven't trained yourself professionally. You haven't dedicated yourself and paid your dues yet to actually build that skill. You have an amazing imagination, you have an amazing passion, but you have to let go of your ego and start looking at your artwork and saying, okay, this is what needs to be fixed. This is what a client is expecting of me. Fill that gap and you'll be set. You'll be good to go. Now you're 35 to 40 years old. You might have had a few little successes and failures along the way. You might have gotten some jobs. They weren't your dream jobs necessarily, but they paid the bills and you could sustain yourself for a little bit. Maybe you got jobs and you lost jobs. Maybe there was a little bit of studio hopping going on. Who knows? But you're not a name yet. You don't have an established, stable career yet. I can tell you with absolute confidence, not only from my own experiences, because I'm 48 years old, right? But from the experiences of countless artists that I've worked with who are my age, right around my age, or very close to it, between your 40 to 48 range, that have an incredible amount of talent because they've dedicated decades of their life to gaining their skills, have an amazing amount of patience and perseverance and dedication. Heck, they're still doing it after several decades. So that, if anything's a testament to that. But they've gotten so caught up in what this studio wants and that director wants and this client wants and this person wants and that person wants that has completely destroyed their integrity. It has completely destroyed their confidence in who they are. Instead, they feel this. The only way I've found any kind of success is by being as incredibly versatile as possible, but that versatility doesn't get me stability. It doesn't get me growth. It just kind of pays my bills well enough up until a certain point. And they feel like frauds. They feel like they were washouts. They weren't good enough. So they were that old crone who said, I could have been somebody, you know, but then you realize you're 67 years old and you never were, and you lived in a state of illusion. You're not. What's happened is, and I can say this from personal experience, is that something in there, some experience over the decades, or many experiences over the decades, pulled you away from analyzing yourself. You got so caught up in what everybody else was doing. You got so caught up in this person's skill and how that person got success and how this person did this and how that person did that, and culminated in a social media environment where you're seeing people who are really big social media celebrities artistically, that you're constantly aware of everything you're not, and you've completely lost sight of everything that you are. I had a chance, I even spoke about it in an art talk recently, a student that I work with, who's my age pretty much, the same age, who was, I mean, if you saw his artwork, and then you saw my artwork, you'd look at my artwork and go, ooh, Adam, you might want to hide that. It doesn't look good. I'll put it to you this way. My artwork doesn't look very good next to his. Yet, I still managed to find something. I still managed to find my niche in my career. And I imagine one of the reasons he came to me is because, hey, okay, this guy is my age. He's been through some shit. He's not some inexperienced artist who's just pretending to know what he's talking about. And we had a real heart-to-heart talk. And my advice to him is, you don't need to get any better at art. Your art was good enough 20 years ago. I said, you just have to have faith in your taste. You have faith in your form of expression. Have faith in what you're doing. It's time for you to let go of the training wheels and draw. It's time for you to reiterate what Anthony said. Anthony Jones, you have to rediscover the cool factor. Because when the learning curve happens, if you think about it, you start early on being a geek, right? A nerd. You just love shit. You're totally fanboying over this stuff. And then the real world kicks in. It's time to be an adult. So technicality kicks in just to get you over that amateur hump. And that, once you get over that hump, you become so dependent on those technicalities. Those technicalities, at a certain point, once you've reached a certain skill level, start to become your crutch. That ladder that you climbed to get up there is now a scaffolding trapping you in it. And you have to be able to walk out of that and just say, hey, I know how to draw now. I know my shit. It's okay, take those training wheels. Now, I want to look back at the Zeldas. I want to look back at the animes. I want to look back at the furries. I want to look back at the things that excited me as an artist growing up. And I want to look back. I want to look at my art again through those child eyes and unapologetically express myself, but have faith that your skill and your professionalism and your common sense will carry you through. And I guarantee you, once you do that, you're going to discover an artist in yourself. You're going to finally, after decades of hard work and dedication, you're going to realize, you're going to have that Mr. Miyagi moment in Karate Kid when he realizes that sanding the floor and painting the fence was actually him learning how to be a really sharp karate expert. And you're going to realize, holy fuck, I'm an expert. But I've been using all of my skill to tell somebody else's story. Many people's stories, and I never told my own through my voice, through what felt authentic to me. And I'm telling you, it's probably going to be the best earned success of your life. And the same exact thing can happen when you're in your 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s. There's no stopwatch waiting for you to learn the fundamentals, learning you to discover yourself, learning to discover your personal style and your community and your niche. There's no timeline. And you know what? Sometimes something that I discovered that kind of brings me back to the whole point of this video in the first place. Sometimes you realize that you've been preparing for something you didn't even realize you were preparing for because it didn't exist yet. A really good example is the kind of art, the style of art that I produce. This very dark, Dark Souls fantasy style of art. I became a huge fan. I jumped onto the Souls boat and became a diehard Souls fan in Dark Souls 2. I dabbled with Dark Souls 1 a little bit, but never gave it a fair chance. But Dark Souls 2 is when I came in and I got my ass handed a few times. Put it down for a couple of months, but then came back and beat my first boss and then realized, oh, wait a minute. I'm addicted. And I've been addicted ever since through the entire Soul series. Sekiro, Bloodborne, Dark Souls 3, Elden Ring, the expansion coming out soon. I'm the one waiting at the front door like some madman banging on the door, telling them to release the expansion. Trust me. But that was a key. The Souls series, the Miyazaki's artistic philosophy. And in my opinion, moving forward, Yes, video games have been recognized as an art form recently, but moving forward, Hidetaka Miyazaki, who's not even an illustrator himself, he's a director, but his vision is going to be regarded as one of the great artistic masters of our time. I stand behind that because I've never been more artistically inspired, both aesthetically, visually, and philosophically, as I am through Miyazaki's work. But I was already an older guy by the time the Soul series came out, but there was this moment, this something clicked in my brain the first time I saw that artwork, the first time I experienced that game and just looked around and took this world in and saw those creatures and started to decode in my brain why these environments and these places and these buildings and these creatures and these characters feel the way they do. There was a feeling there that just, it felt like home to me. And I went, I need to decode this shit. And I did. And I've been doing this ever since in my artwork. Doesn't mean I just produce Souls art. No, but the Souls genre, the Souls philosophy is at the core of what I do. But it's not only at the core of my art. It's also at the core of this fucking conversation. Because if you know Miyazaki, if you know the Souls game, if you've dedicated yourself to it, if you've overcome the immediate humbling obstacle of its unapologetic difficulty, as some people like to call it, something happens inside. You start to get feelings. These feelings are normal. It's okay. It happens to all of us. Don't be ashamed. It's okay. You start to fall in love with the challenge. You start to fall in love with this excitement that you get when a creature who had no intention, an entity, a thing in your life that had no intention and no obligation to give a fuck about how you feel about it, and kicks your ass every single time, and if you complain about the rhythm of the game and the amount of damage that this character does and the fact that this character never gives you 2 seconds to get your breath while it slices away at you and completely destroys your health bar, and you're throwing your remote around and you're losing your shit and having total freaking meltdowns because of it, and it doesn't care, and you keep going back for some sadomasochistic reason, you keep going back to fight this thing, to go back and back and back and have everything, have all your money taken away from you and have to start all the way over from scratch and gather up more money and gather up more souls and try very slowly and carefully to level yourself up and level yourself up, and then it kills you again and you lose everything again and you have to start fucking over again and fucking over again. But then you beat it. Then in some heart-pounding, palmy, sweaty palm moment, you're sitting there and you go, fuck yes! And you do it! And you beat it! And your neighbors think you're having a nervous breakdown because you left your window open and it's 2 o'clock in the morning and you just screamed at the top of your lungs, fuck you! Yes! I did it! You did. You beat it. You beat the impossible. You overcame the fucking impossible. And whew, you consume its soul. And now it's yours. And now you have this beautiful, shiny reward that you earned. Is it the most beautifully designed, most powerful reward you've ever had in your entire life? Most beautifully designed 3D model of a weapon or an armor or a soul or whatever? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how pretty it is. It matters that it's yours and you fucking earned it. Through blood, sweat, and tears. Didn't you? And then there's going to be another and another. And you realize now the bosses are getting harder, but now I'm not only learning the rhythm of the game and I'm starting to figure this shit out, I'm starting to become a more versed player and a more versed understander of all the goings-on and the philosophy and the movement patterns and parry mechanics and all this kind of shit. You're not only figuring that out, but you're also realizing that in order for you to get better at this game, you have to respect it first. It's not about just charging into battle and swinging and hopefully you can mash your buttons and something's gonna happen. You're never gonna win that way. No, you gotta sit down, observe, watch, take it in, learn the pattern, go over and over and over again. Don't just charge in, stand back, hold your shield up, analyze what's going on, become smart, fight smart, not hard. Okay, I'm starting to understand the philosophy behind this. I can figure this asshole out. Every single obstacle in my life has a rhythm, has a pattern to it, and you start to become sensitive to the energy of the land. And you keep doing this for weeks and months, and every single time you beat something and you find yourself standing there on some lookout, looking over at Anor Londo, right? And you go, oh, I've earned this view. I've earned this view. I've earned this perspective. I've earned this reward called life, called achievement, called success, called integrity. I've earned it. It belongs to me. Is it the biggest reward? No. The biggest reward is way up there. You see that big mountain of gold? That's the big reward. No, you just have a little scratched up old gem in your hand, but it's the best fucking gem you've ever held in your life. You own this shit, and you're going to protect it for the rest of your life. And you keep doing that, and keep doing that, until you beat the end boss. And then what do you want once you've beat that? Once you beat the end boss, once the Elden Lord is destroyed and killed, and you've got his beautiful sacred relic sword, and you go, and now you can start farming and gathering all those souls and having fun and clearing through entire mobs of people with this beautiful sword. What do you want next? New game plus. You want to start it all over again and relive the excitement of the challenge. You don't want to just sit there on top and go, nice sword. Do some like lightsaber dance with it, do all that shit. No, you can do that for about 10 minutes, but then as soon as you go, oh, okay. No, you go right back and you start over again, don't you? And then you go again, and a new get. Before you know it, it's new game plus 11. And the whole reason you're doing this is because you want to extract even more out of every experience, and you want the challenge, you want that feeling of overcoming something. You realize that the difficulty, the challenge, the doubt, the fear, the insecurity, the imposter syndrome, the feeling like you don't know what skills you need in order to get to the next point, the frustration you get talking to different professionals and getting different contradicting pieces of advice, the looking at your portfolio and not knowing whether or not it's good enough and if anybody's going to look at it, the making cold calls to all these different companies, dropping webs, you know, going to websites and filling out those stupid fucking application forms, to reaching out to people on LinkedIn and asking them to sharing your information and links to your portfolio that they obviously never looked at, to feeling like you're too old, you've missed the boat, you're already fucking 56 years old, nobody's gonna hire you at this point. Who's gonna hire an old artist who's never even had a professional job in their life? Or a 18-year-old young professional, 20-year-old young professional who's got no industry experience, or a 35-year-old who's still living at mommy's house. You're exactly where you're supposed to be. You're nestled nice and cozy inside this comfy little unpredictable world called hardship. And that hardship is the whole fucking reason you're here in the first place. That's why you're here. If you're sitting there doubting yourself, feeling like shit, working day after day, trying to improve your skills, trying to consult with different people to try to get a clear idea of what the hell to do with yourself, feeling like you're too old, feeling like you're too young, feeling like you're too middle-aged, and everything in between, then good. You're exactly where you're supposed to be. Now, of course, if those feelings are overwhelming, if you're suffering depression, if you're thinking about hurting yourself, that's not professional difficulty. That's something you need to speak to a professional for. There's no pep talk that's going to help you overcome a chemical issue. It's just not, or a neurological issue, depending on the situation. You need to either surround yourself in a community of people who understand you, who can talk the talk, who speak in a language that you understand, or speak to a professional who can help you overcome the unnecessary additional challenges that you're dealing with in your life. But everything else, my dear lady and gentlemen, is fair game. And if you're sitting there feeling absolutely frustrated and you're thinking they're going, I'm gonna fucking break this goddamn remote, aka stylus, that costs you $300 goddamn dollars. I wanna just take this iPad and just frisbee it into the wall. I'm so fed up with this fucking career. Number one, don't break the remote because it's expensive and you're broke, so don't do it. Breathe, put it down. A couple of Namyoho Renge Kyos will get you through, okay? Give yourself a break, make yourself a cup of tea or coffee and hot chocolate, and then when you're feeling better and less homicidal, pick it up again, respect the craft, remember, work smart, not hard, analyze the rhythms and patterns of life, of the career, of your skills, and I guarantee you, you will overcome this unsurmountable obstacle. Okay? With that said, I love you all with all my heart, and happy painting. Take care.